Thank you for the invitation, Justin. So this conference rationally notes that the Oxford English Dictionary defines post-truth as relating to or denoting circumstances in which objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotional and personal belief. One could argue that there is nothing particularly new about this phenomenon, as ancient engagement with Aristotle's rhetoric indicates. Emotions and personal belief have always had a prominent role in the configuration of public opinion. Nevertheless, the term post-truth has been coined to register our current experience as a relatively new situation, something that we could describe as a change in the inherited cultural regime. Namely, whereas the cultural regime relied on objective facts to articulate a shareable public sphere, the late modern cultural regime seems to be marked by a decreasing faith in the power of objective facts to generate social trust and articulate civil society. The emotionalization, is that a difficult word, of the public sphere and a growing perception that the alliance between technology and political interests massively distorts factual truths have undermined that faith. A faith that had already been shaken by other intellectual developments in the last century. While due to their contingency, factual truths lack the aura of mathematical or philosophical truths, they are particularly stubborn and impact many other contingent opinions. After all, factual truths are nothing other than opinions that happen to be the case. Yet that circumstance, namely, the fact that it is or is not the case, makes the whole difference. Factual truths indicate that not everything depends on our thoughts or our interests, that some conditions must be accepted in order for us to coexist. Factual truths play a decisive role in social life, as well as in the advancement of scientific knowledge. Yet over the last century, we have been insistently told that so-called objective facts are difficult to establish and are always in need of interpretation, that when it comes to practical matters, they can be framed, selected, and used in alternative ways, and that they rarely have the last word. As a result, it is no wonder that many have grown skeptical of the very attempt to define objective facts, since we have been taught to be suspicious of the particular interests behind every move. And yet, the social reaction against the decreasing influence of objective facts in the shaping of public opinion is eloquent in one regard. No matter how difficult they are to obtain, nobody really wants to be deceived about so-called objective facts, even if we all can acknowledge a tendency to deceive ourselves in that we grow attached to the opinions that best fit our prejudices, our interests. We all make a distinction between facts and interests and regard it as crucial for the articulation of individual and social life. Yet, can we really identify truth with objective facts, as the Oxford definition of post-truth implicitly suggests? In my view, the increasing role of emotions in the shaping of public opinion is also an indicator that, as a society, we are little convinced that objective facts as such represent the whole truth, which we expect for the articulation of human interaction and social life. Aristotle composed his rhetoric because this is not always the case, and indeed is seldom the case. In that treatise, he studied the three elements that make up persuasive discourse: ethos, pathos, and logos. He also made it clear that verisimilitude is not to be confused with truth, since the latter should also mind extra discursive objective facts. Since Aristotle was particularly interested in political and legal discourses, he took those facts to be registered by witnesses, confessions, and documents. To these facts today, we could readily add the facts of science. Nevertheless, the whole point of Aristotle's rhetoric was precisely to investigate why facts alone do not offer persuasive public discourse. Indeed, to offer persuasive discourse, one must consider relevant arguments, the audience's emotions, and the speaker's character. Realizing that persuasion requires those elements does not necessarily go against the human desire for truth. Rather, it may be taken as a sign that the human desire for truth entails more than the human desire for objective facts. From this perspective, it could perhaps be argued that it is not simply the public desire for truth that has entered into crisis. Crisis brews rather around a naive account of publicly relevant truth, namely that which divorces facts from discourses, emotions, and character. This naive account of truth sees facts as capable of being meaningfully articulated in the absence of an appropriate discourse and of being persuasive in the absence of an appropriate speaker or audience. In a classical approach, truth resides in judgment. It consists of a reflective adequacy of understanding and reality. In approaching truth through the principle of verification, the logical positivists emphasize the idea of truth as adequacy, but in a reductive way that excluded philosophical and ethical questions, and therefore particularly significant human questions from the realm of truth. For logical positivism, metaphysical and ethical questions are beyond truth, they are not. Accordingly, I would like to suggest that post-truth society is not marked so much by the crisis of truth as by the crisis of an public relevance of an abstract and positivist account of truth. This crisis has been nourished by different intellectual developments in the 20th century, which could be seen as reactions to positivism. In the end, what do we mean when we speak of objective facts? How objective are the facts of science? This matter has been contested throughout the last century. To conjure up a naive approach to scientific objectivity, suffice it to recall Bruno Latour, you mentioned Bruno Latour in your book, Ethnographic Approach to the Way Scientific Facts Are Produced in a Laboratory. I have a footnote recording this. While methodological discussion and the standardization of scientific procedures that ensure the replicability of experiments can be taken as a sufficient sign of scientific truth, they also indicate that such truth is everything but a simple fact, or rather that those facts are to a great extent artifacts. Such artifacts are constructed in conversational exchanges intertwined with context-dependent considerations that impose their own particular conditions on the formulation of the problem in question and inevitably incorporate a persuasive dimension. Indeed, in order to get the relevant facts, we not only need to control scientific procedures, but also to advance the right questions in the midst of context-dependent factors. Realizing that science is a human activity and thus subject to the constraints of other human activities does not compromise theoretical achievements. This is important. Of course, to formulate the right questions, we need to anticipate a general view of how things interact with one another. In other words, we need a theory. Yet, according to Popper, general theories cannot be verified, but only falsified. Thus, the truth is not to be thought of as the proper object of science, except in the sense of a task, for Popper. In saying that the task of science is the search for truth, Popper actually takes truth to be a regulative idea that guides scientific research. Ultimately, he also takes science to be an activity aimed at the acquisition of interesting truth. This is his words. It is truth that involves answers to our problems. The notion of interest thus plays an important role in Popper's approach to scientific research, which is thus clearly framed in human terms as a practical activity governed by the regulative idea of truth, as well as and importantly, by the idea of relevance. Human interests emerge then as the proper source of the meaningful questions at the root of scientific endeavors in charge of producing scientific facts. Accordingly, scientific progress is built on continuous feedback between meaningful questions and satisfactory answers, between theory and experiment. Insofar as this feedback is the result of an ongoing human activity carried out amid many constraints, Society relies on the moral integrity of the scientific community performing this task. A moral integrity that is articulated around intellectual integrity and can be defined by a prevailing desire for truth. This integrity is particularly demanding when discussing the actual implications of scientific discoveries for social life. At this point, we abandon the scientific discussion and enter the political arena, where many factors play a decisive role, not least of which include the contrasted facts of science and the related discourses that articulate logoi, emotions, and character. While, as pointed out above, a scientific activity, like every other human activity, relies on interest and entails some level of persuasion, as long as we remain within the scientific community, spurious elements can be more clearly controlled by the prevailing desire for truth. Yet, as soon as scientific results enter the public realm, interest for truth competes with other human interests. Accordingly, the temptation to distort objective facts when they contradict other, perhaps legitimate interests, is always at hand. Plato's Gorgias points out the main risk involved at this point, when the famous rhetorician describes the power of his art to Socrates. I quote Plato, well, Gorgias actually. I shall relate to you a great piece of evidence. On many occasions now, I have gone in with my brother and with other doctors to one of the sick who was unwilling either to drink a drug or to submit himself to the doctor for surgery or casually, or perhaps being fascinated anyway. The doctor being unable to persuade him, I persuaded him by no other art than rhetoric. And I assert further that if a rhetorical man and a doctor should go into any city you wish and should have to contest in a speech, in the assembly, or in some other gathering, which of the two ought to be chosen, the doctor would plainly be nowhere. But the man with power to speak would be chosen if he wished. And if he should contest against any other craftsman whatsoever, the rhetorician, rather than anyone else, would persuade them to choose himself. For there is nothing about which the rhetorician would not speak more persuasively than any other craftsman in a multitude. The power of the art then is so great and of such sort, end quote. Later in the same dialogue, Socrates contends that rhetoric is not an art, but a practice or an experience. This is so because it operates without real knowledge and deals not so much with real goods, but with apparent ones, which appeal to those who lack proper knowledge and are prone to follow mere appearances. The comparison he draws with medicine and cooking is illustrative in this regard. If the cook and the doctor had to contest among children or among men as thoughtless as children, which of the two, the doctor or the cook, has understanding about useful and bad foods, the doctor would die of hunger. This, therefore, I call flattery, and I assert that such thing is shameful, Paulus, because it guesses at the pleasant without the best. And I assert that it is not art but experience, because it has not reasoned account in regard to the thing it administers, of what sort of things they are in their nature. And so it cannot state the cause of each thing. And I do not call art a business that lacks a reasoned account. End quote. When dealing with people who lack proper knowledge and expertise, those who master the art of persuasion can be more convincing than real experts. For this reason, Socrates had misgivings about rhetoric in that it can be used for good or for bad. In his reply, Gorgias argued, saying that along with rhetoric, he would also teach justice to his students, but Socrates was not convinced. For him, the morally ambivalent character of rhetoric constitutes a permanent threat, which in practice dilutes the difference between rhetoric and sophistry. In his view, the multitude would always be persuaded by the sophists rather than by the experts. In a way, Plato could be taken as the first to voice concern for objective facts objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and interest or personal belief. His philosopher King proposal may reasonably sound just as crazy, but it was meant to underline the need for being governed by reason. Yet he was not very optimistic in that regard. If we tend to think that post-truth represents a new phenomenon, it's probably because after Enlightenment appeals to reason and education, and two centuries of sustained effort to increase the population's cultural level, increased critical thinking among citizenry might have been expected. Yet, as the contemporary phenomenon of post-truth suggests, this is far from being the case. Since people seem just as vulnerable to flattering arguments, either arguments that affirm their antecedent interests or tastes, as plea to fear. For him, the problem is found in the multitude's intrinsically mediocre character, which is more easily moved and directed by emotions than by reason. At the beginning of the 20th century, Georg Simmel expressed a similar view. As soon as great masses are set into motion, politically, socially, or religiously, they display a thoughtless radicalism, a triumph of extremist parties over moderate ones. Underlying this, first of all, is that large masses can be satisfied and governed only by simple ideas. What is common to many must also be accessible to the lowest, most primitive mind among them. And even higher and more sophisticated personalities will never in great numbers concur in the complicated and highly developed, but rather in the relatively simple, commonly human images and impulses, end quote. For Plato, the manipulability of the masses represents an argument against democracy. In his sociology, Simmel observes that this was precisely why Romans counted the vote divided among groups. Yet, insofar as Plato was comparing expert knowledge with rhetorical arguments that appeal to emotions and interests, he ignored the peculiarity of practical reason, which operates in the political realm and cannot be equated with expert's reason or with irrational emotion. As Hannah Arendt argues, Plato's approach to political matters was guided by an attempt to replicate the kind of authority that he found in expert knowledge in the political realm, in order to overcome the risk of deception that he recognized in rhetorical persuasion. The problem, however, is that politics deals with contingent constellations of facts and interests that cannot be appropriately governed by scientific reason, but rather require deliberation on the multiple interests involved at every turn. This amounts to saying that political reason and such is not so much concerned with theoretical or factual truths, but rather with practical truths. That is, it's not so much concerned with existing knowledge, but rather with how we use that knowledge to further certain ends that we deem good and fair. Well, it's important to note that the normative dimension of truth works differently in the realm of science and in the political arena. In the political arena, we need focus on practical truth. Aristotle defines practical truth when he says, pursuit and avoidance in the sphere of desire correspond to affirmation and denial in that of thought. So since virtue of character is a state involving rational choice, and rational choice is deliberative desire, the reason must be true and the desire correct if the rational choice is to be good. And desire must pursue what reason asserts. Such thought and truth are practical. I would like to focus on that, but since I don't have much time, the important thing is to see that practical truth is neither theoretical abstract truth nor irrational emotion. It involves right desire, but also involving factual truths, relevant truths. So, if we miss the idea of practical truth, we are in a dialectic between technocracy and populism very easily. It's very difficult to avoid that dialectic. So let me move to a relevant quote by Hannah Arendt in the end of my talk. Because I have to skip some pages. She says, in the text that Professor Zamani quoted at the beginning, while probably no former time tolerated so many diverse opinions on religious or philosophical matters, factual truth, if it happens to oppose a given group's profit or pleasure, is greeted today with greater hostility than ever before. Even more disturbing is that to the extent to which unwelcome factual truths are tolerated in free countries, they are often consciously or unconsciously transformed into opinions. This she wrote in the 60s. So she anticipated in many ways what we now experience as post-truth. But she further added a relevant idea about how truthfulness has become, precisely because of this, a political virtue. It had never been a political virtue. Eh? But she said, truthfulness had never been counted among the political virtues because it has little indeed to contribute to that change of the world and of circumstances, which is among the most legitimate activities. Only where a community has embarked upon organized line on principle and not only with respect to particulars, can truthfulness as such, unsupported by the distorting forces of power and interest, become a political factor of the first order. Where everybody lies about everything of importance, the truth teller, whether he knows it or not, has begun to act in the sense of changing things. He too has engaged himself in political business. For in the unlikely event that he survives, this is really tragic, but he has made a start toward changing the world. So this idea, I think it's relevant, and we have to a certain extent, recent example in the figure of Vaclav Havel. Vaclav Havel, in his times, he wrote a book with this title, The Power of the Powerless. And he meant precisely the idea of truth. Truth made a difference in order to finish the Soviet domination in the east of Europe. It was the power of the powerless. No? I think that while some people find certain populist discourses persuasive, despite many scientists raising their voices to the contrary, it is because the social dynamic that influences public opinion is not merely sustained by knowledge or cognition, but also it's sustained by interests and emotions. And politicians touch on short-term interests and emotions more easily than scientists and philosophers. But in their sober hours, most people trust the word of people professionally committed to truth. So an important idea here is that those people who, because of their professions, are particularly committed to truth, they have ethical integrity. So I'm saying something very obvious, but very relevant. Professional ethics is a key in order to overcome the post-truth society.
Thank you, Anna Marta. So now.